Greetings, church family. Today's daily Bible reading, of course, had us beginning the book of Isaiah, chapter 1. We see in verses 1 through 15, sin and its consequences begin heavy and hard here. After briefly introducing the prophet writer of this book, Isaiah, in verse 1, we see the words of Yahweh through the prophet, verse 2, declaring the utter wretched sinfulness of the people God had chosen to belong to him. And notice the bevy of descriptions of this horrid wickedness. Verse 2, Israel had revolted against God. Verse 3, not knowing or understanding their own master, Yahweh. Verse 4, they are a sinful nation, weighed down with iniquity, offspring of evildoers, sons who act corruptly, having abandoned, despised, turned away from Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel. Verse 5, rebellious, sick, and faint with sin. Verse 6, lacking anything sound, filled with wounds and damage. Verse 10, they're like Sodom and Gomorrah. Verses 11 through 13, they're empty, worthless offerings and sacrifices, and they're hypocritical festivals with zero devotion to the Lord from the heart. And what are the consequences of such sin? Well, verses 7 through 9 describe it. Desolation of the promised land, strangers, primarily at this point Assyria, attacking the citizens of Israel and burning its cities as they besiege them. Verses 14 through 15, God temporarily turning his back on his people, wearily hating their sacrifices and outward shows of obedience, even ignoring their prayers. Then we get to verses 16 through 20, we see holiness and God's forgiveness. There's a brief hope spot here. God calls his people to repent in verse 16, to put on holy living in place of their wickedness in verse 17. Verse 18, there's a promise of forgiveness for sin to those who forsake their sin and turn back to the Lord. And by the end of this book, Isaiah will certainly give much more detail about how God's going to accomplish this forgiveness and who exactly will bring that about. Verse 19, the good blessings that would result from repentantly trusting in the Lord under the Mosaic covenant, in which the condition of the promised land was a major aspect. Verse 20, the punishment that would result from continuing to rebel against God. Then we get to verses 21 through 31, corruption and salvation of Zion. Yahweh turns his attention to the city of Zion, Jerusalem, which was once a paragon of virtue as the capital city of the kingdom of Israel. But by Isaiah's time, it had become more well known for the iniquity of its citizens. And God describes it as a murderous harlot who had cheated on him, right, with idols, with sin. Verse 21, verse 22, full of impurity. Verse 23, rebellious, thieving, dishonest, greedy, and selfish. But rather than cast the city away, God graciously states that he's going to purify it. Purifying requires that he would avenge himself on all his foes, not just those who came from pagan nations, but also Israelites who rebelled against him. And such disciplinary punishment would be painful for the people of Israel. And as we know, it ended with their exile and captivity in foreign nations, Assyria for the northern kingdom, Babylon for the southern. Well, some principles that we can gather from this chapter. One, we need to always remember this principle about sin. God views our sin in the way that he described there in verses 2 through 6. And he's going to respond with consequences for our sin, which verses 7 through 15 and 25 through 31 really attest to. Just think about that again. Our sin is revolting against God. It's showing a lack of knowledge and understanding of who he is. It shows that we're weighed down with iniquity, offspring of evildoers, sons who act corruptly, abandoned, despised, turned away from the Lord, rebellious, sick and faint with sin, lacking anything sound. We're like Sodom and Gomorrah in our sin against the Lord. And if we live a life of sin, then any kind of good actions on the outside, well, they're like those empty, worthless sacrifices and offerings, hypocritical festivals, zero heart for the Lord. And then verses 27 through 28 really lays it out for us when we think about this context. What do we see there? Zion will be redeemed with justice and her repentant ones with righteousness, but transgressors and sinners will be crushed together, and those who forsake Yahweh will come to an end. Romans 6:23 puts it this way, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And if you have not done so, repent and believe in Christ Jesus as your Lord, as your master, as your savior from God's wrath, which is to come. He is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no life without coming to the Lord through Christ in faith, and it's a repentant faith. Another principle, God cares that what belongs to him would be pure just as he is pure, without sin. And that's why he disciplines, he chastises those whom he loves to hit us with the refiner's fire, to boil away the impurity. Hebrews 12, 7 through 13 says, it is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you're without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, so that we may share his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak, the knees that are feeble. Make straight paths for your feet, so that the limb, which is lame, may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. A lot to think on and contemplate there as we beg the Lord to produce holiness in our lives. Prepare for discipline to help purify us from sin day by day. Of course, it all begins with faith in Christ, and it continues with faith in Christ. And putting off that sin, trusting that He is the better way, that He is the life, that He is truth, and that there is nothing in this world that should ever, ever, ever distract us from Him. Nothing in this world that we should chase after, as the Israelites here did, the people of Judah, and received that punishment from the Lord. This has been Isaiah chapter 1. I hope you have a great day.